everybody. Thanks for coming out tonight. Super rainy and cold. Welcome to Winging. I'm Cindy Barbahan. I'm the chair of the planning board. And with us tonight is the entire board and staff of the planning board. And we're here tonight to ask you for what you would like to see in our accessory dwelling unit bylaw that we would like to craft and put forward to town meeting in the fall. So I'm not going to take up a lot of time with details because Amy's going to give you a lot of specifics, but I just want to kind of start out and motivate the conversation just a little bit. And one of the things I want to say is, well, this, I'm going to give you one stat. 1970s, Bedford. Average size, square foot of the house, less than 2,000. Average occupancy, about 5. Today, what do you think the numbers are? We're talking upwards of 4,000 with an average occupancy of 2.2 human beings in those houses. So there's a lot of reasons to have these accessory dwelling units, both attached and detached, and we're going to talk about them in detail tonight. But I just want to motivate the idea that Bedford has always prided itself as a community that has character. And a community that is a community. You know your neighbors, everybody's friendly. But in reality, if we're only generating McMansions that are million plus size houses, and we're occupying them with two people, most likely both people are having to work full time to support the mortgage on this house, how well do we really know our neighbors? Do we even have a community anymore? So accessory dwelling units are supposed to be something that can kind of help intergenerationally for a lot of situations. It helps downsize, it helps seniors that are in town and in houses that are too big that they can't afford to really live in anymore. They don't want the space anymore, but they have no option if they want to stay in town. Where are they going to go? Likewise, lots of us have had kids that went through Bedford school systems. They went through nice colleges. Maybe they have some accumulated loans to the point where they might have a job, but they don't have enough money to actually sustain their own rent, or more, let alone mortgage. So introducing the concept of ADUs, both attached and detached, is going to allow a lot more flexibility for people that want to stay in town, just to make town a more vibrant place, a place where there's people that are small, young, medium-aged, old, everybody playing together well, and a place where you could see your neighbors and interact more and really kind of recreate a community atmosphere. So that's all I want to say. And Amy's going to take it over and give you a lot more specifics. And then the idea is after that, we're going to break out into groups, and we're going to talk in detail about some of the things that we've kind of put forward, and it's all straw man stuff. So nothing is concrete yet. And what we really want is to hear from you in town, what's going to make this viable? What's going to make this thing appealing for you as a town, as a resident in town, as a neighbor of someone who might build one, or one that you want to build yourself? How can we craft the zoning bylaw so that it's something that everybody's going to like? Okay? So thank you for coming tonight, and we're really looking forward to all of your input. So talk away when we break up, okay? Thank you.
Hi. I hope you will excuse the froggy voice. I'm getting over the flu. My name is Amy Lloyd. Thank you again all for coming out tonight. You just heard from Cindy, our current chair this year. We also have Sean Hannigan, Jeff Cohen, Mark Siegenthaler all on the board, as well as our two planners, Tony Fields and Catherine Perry. This is what the flu does to my brain. I apologize. So, what is an accessory dwelling unit? Very simply put, an ADU is an additional separate living space on a single family residential lot. That's the kernel of it. An ADU might be internal to the primary house, an addition onto the house, or it can be a separate detached structure. ADUs are, by definition, secondary to the primary residence, and so are differentiated from two family dwellings, most typically by the requirements of a small subordinate physical character and an owner presence on the property. In areas like ours, where housing markets are tight and small households are common, but the housing stock is mostly larger single-family houses, there is increasing interest in creating a stock of accessory dwellings as a way to help meet demand and reduce sprawl. Reducing the informal economy by legalizing accessory units can also improve safety through better code compliance. AARP has identified ADUs as having potential to improve the options available to seniors, and the state of Massachusetts is certainly interested in increasing the housing supply in general. Here in Bedford, our current zoning bylaw provides for accessory apartments, describing them as, and this is a bit of a mouthful, a second dwelling unit located within a structure constructed as a detached one-family dwelling, subordinate in size to the principal dwelling, and separated from it in a manner that maintains the appearance of the structure as a one-family unit. But note that the current bylaw does not allow for detached units. The major provisions in the current bylaw specify owner occupancy on the property, no more than two bedrooms in the ADU, a requirement for at least two off-street parking spaces, and the allowable size is calculated as 30% of the primary house's gross square footage. There are 56 listed legal ADUs in Bedford, including a couple of grandfathered detached dwellings, but it is to be assumed that there are some additional informal ADUs as well. Interestingly, Bedford does allow for some finished living spaces to be detached, such as home businesses or recreation rooms like home gyms or the so-called man cave. In the communities abutting Bedford, all allow ADUs of some form, excepting Billerica, which has generous zoning for two-family housing. Carlisle, Lincoln, Lexington, Acton, Littleton, and a number of other towns in the greater metro area permit detached ADUs. So why is the Planning Board proposing to revise our ADU bylaw? We hope that carefully considered ADU updates can help expand housing diversity, accommodate changing family needs. Sorry. Tony will have to come fix that. And create an income stream that can help young families enter the market and seniors age in place. Clearly, ADUs aren't the only answer to our housing issues, but they are one useful item in the housing toolkit. As I mentioned before, there are three basic types of ADU: internal, attached, and detached. Historically, detached secondary dwellings weren't uncommon. Sometimes they were space above a carriage house or a barn, sometimes simply a small house at the back of a larger house, and several of these actually still exist in Bedford today. Detached ADUs are attractive to many homeowners because they give greater privacy for both the owner and the tenant. Where an elderly family member is the ADU occupant, detached units can give a sense of greater independence. ADUs are a type of housing that is often underrepresented in many communities, especially suburban ones, namely less expensive, small units for small households. ADUs can be an affordable option in a difficult housing market. Family needs change over time, and ADUs can adapt to those changes. They can house a nanny or au pair, an adult child needing to return home, or an aging parent wanting to be closer to family. For seniors wanting to age in place, ADUs can provide an income stream to help with home maintenance costs or house a property or personal caretaker. Unlike two-family dwellings, which can be of equal size, ADU bylaws require the units to be subordinate to the primary dwelling. Every study on ADUs we found had strong recommendations on size limitations for reasons ranging from maintaining affordability to limiting resource use. The Massachusetts Municipal Association's 2019 Best Practices document asks towns to consider adopting a square footage cap instead of the percentage of primary dwelling, such as we already have here in Bedford. They also say that the average ADU size for Massachusetts is 800 to 900 square feet. The Planning Board is considering an 800 square foot cap on all ADUs. For reference, a standard two-car garage is 24 feet by 24 feet. Place a half a story above that, and the combined square footage is conveniently just about 800 square feet. 800 square feet is typically a fairly roomy one-bedroom or a modest two-bedroom house. The visual impact of detached ADUs is also an important consideration, and so the board will propose a height limit. We're considering 25 feet and 1.5 stories. This is the height limit for the new construction houses at Pine Hill Crossing, the old Coast Guard housing, for reference. A detached ADU's lot placement is likewise important to its visual impact. In all residential districts, Bedford requires 15-foot side and 30-foot rear setbacks for the primary dwelling. Accessory structures, on the other hand, buildings like garages and sheds, only have a 10-foot setback requirement on all sides, including the rear. And per building code, all buildings must be at least 10 feet apart. This would not change under any scenario. The side setback question is perhaps a little easier to determine. Even though an ADU is an accessory structure, the 15-foot side setback is a well-established norm in Bedford. The rear setback is a different consideration. A 30-foot setback for a detached ADU would eliminate many geometrically irregular but nonetheless conforming lots from building a detached unit. In those that would be able to build, the structures would be more crowded together, reducing available space for landscaping screening and increasing overall visual impact. Additionally, it would reduce privacy for both units. The board is considering a 15-foot rear setback for ADUs with additional privacy provisions around door and window placement specifications. Parking regulations for ADUs vary widely. Currently, Bedford bylaw requires at least 2 off-street parking spaces for an ADU. Many cities have no parking requirements at all. But because Bedford doesn't allow overnight on-street parking, and these residential lots will be owner-occupied, owners might presumably construct whatever number of spaces are needed for their particular situation. However, there are important questions of parking placement and screening, and so the board is considering a parking requirement, possibly at least 1 space. The process by which ADUs are permitted is critical to their overall success or failure. By this, I mean that greater regulatory restrictions mean higher costs for homeowners and thus less likelihood that an ADU will be built. In the planning world, the term by right means that an owner can build and use a property according to the strictly defined criteria within the zoning bylaw without having to ask for any further permissions. I should note also that non-zoning related permitting will all stay in force, like building permits and Conservation Commission permits. Anytime a special permit is required, it costs the homeowner more time and more money, and multiple studies find that this often creates a significant barrier to building ADUs. We currently have a by right process for ADUs with clear criteria in the zoning bylaw, and the board would like to maintain that for conforming properties. However, there is the potential for many special cases. There are non-conforming lots, lots that have some sort of natural constraint like wetlands or ledge, and existing accessory structures that don't conform to the required setbacks. All these require special consideration. The board is still discussing and taking comments on this topic. It is certain that special permits will be required in many of these cases, but there is still much to consider. Now, we'd like to break you into, do you think we should take 2 or 3 groups? We're sort of right on the cusp of number of people.
Amy, you've got a question.
Smaller is better.
We're going to break into discussion groups and do a whole lot of questioning and answering based around special topics. And then we'll all reconvene after each group discusses and answer any further questions. Do you have a general question you wanted to ask right now?
I heard Cindy saying you want to craft the zoning bylaw. You mean revise the current zoning bylaw?
Yes.
Because we already have, right?
That's correct.
Right, and do you know the basis for the current zoning bylaw? What was the basis to come up with all those requirements? Has anybody done a study of why the town came up with those specifics before you change it?
I'm not sure quite what you mean by basis, but ADUs are a well-established housing form.
The specific zoning bylaw. May I introduce myself first? Or do we want to get into that?
Let's just answer this question that we're going to break
meeting?
Out.
Is this like a...
Yes, it's an information session. I just don't want to take time away from everybody to be able to break into discussion questions and give their comments.
Can I?
I just mark it. may have been on the planning board at that time, and you were looking like you wanted to answer.
Well, I just briefly, many of the same questions were there when we passed the first bylaw. The first bylaw was passed because there were interested owners. I specifically remember a couple of families that had older parents.
And that was me.
And so at the time, the combination of the Housing Committee and the Planning Board tried to create a bylaw that was by right, so that people would know under the rules you either can go ahead and do this or you can't, because you can either meet the requirements or you can't. At the time, there were concerns that a special permit would simply make it too difficult for people, so they wouldn't actually be able to take advantage of it. And there were also concerns at the time, a number of communities were considering adding affordability requirements to the apartments, and we didn't want to do that either. Just by their nature, accessory apartments tend to be a lower cost housing option, and so at the time we were satisfied with that we were creating an option. It had some affordability to it without having to require affordability, and we tried to do it under by right, so that people would be clear that they could or couldn't do it. And not have a whole lot of people trying to get
it. But the specifics with regard to 30% and, you know, everything else that went into the bylaw, you know, those specifics, there was a reason behind that, and there was a thought process before we tried to change anything. I think we have to understand why we set those requirements in our zoning bylaw, which, you know, I've read it because, as I said, I was one of the initial petitioners in 1991. For my situation, and they came up with the bylaws that far exceeded what I expected at that point. Now it seems like we want to change it again, but before we change anything, I think we have to understand what was the reason that the town came up with those specifics requirements. Has to be envelope within the house, can't be more than 30%, it has to be this or that. Now it seems like we want to loosen up the requirements and go with something more. And I'm not saying I'm for it or against it, I just want to know whether we have done our homework to go to a place that we all want to be there.
So, we had another forum this afternoon, so we got more, had another opportunity for you to come. In the afternoon forum, I had a long discussion with someone who was there, and apparently I wasn't part of the, I don't even know if I was in town, I wasn't in town for this, but the first time the zoning amendment was brought forward to town meeting, it was
1991.
Right, but there was no max, there was no 30%. It was just kind of open-ended, and it tanked at town meeting. And then the zoning board came back, the planning board came back the next year with a 30% cap to try to see if that would appease people. I think one of the fears back then when it was really open-ended was that we were creating multifamily housing, and we weren't trying to do that. We were trying to create accessory dwelling units, and that's why the 30% cap, it was my understanding, was put into existence.
Just to add a brief point, I think the first version of the bylaw with the 30% was for internal units, and then a couple of years later, because it seemed to be going well and perhaps wasn't generating a large number of units, it was decided to go a bit further and allow attached accessory dwelling units. At that point, the 30% was left in place, but it actually works out a little bit different if you're adding on an attached amount of volume, and then you've got 30% of the two combined. So if you're going to think about why it's as it is, I don't think it's kind of working perfectly anyway. It's a little bit messy.
So the reality is the state of the world has changed. We're having a housing crisis at the national level, the state level, the local level, in every town, not just ours. And what we're doing here today is, regardless of what the historical context was for any predecessor of the bylaw, we're here today to try to make it more something that everybody in town can do if they want to create either an attached and possibly a detached dwelling unit, depending on your needs. some people might prefer one or the other. We want to give people in town the more options to be able to create these kind of living opportunities. Key multi-generational living opportunities. We're not looking, I mean, it will be the case that it's owner-occupied and the second housing unit, and one of them has to be, or the two units, one of them is owner-occupied. You could lease out to some, so you don't know. But in most cases, we're anticipating this, like, downsizing juniors either moving in or your kids are moving back home. You're just creating more options. So without getting more waylaid, what we'd like to do is break into groups and talk about the straw man, and it is a straw man that the zoning that we have crafted here. And we really want to know what you think about all of the specifics that we're throwing out there, one way or the other, so that we can really come up with something that the whole town is behind before we get to town meeting. So let's do three groups, I think. So 1, 2, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. So like three groups of six, and one board where the orange is, one where the green is, and one where the yellow is. And like six people each, we'll stay in those places and we'll rotate the boards and we'll have discussions led by each of the board members at those points. And then we'll come back and circle and talk about what some of our major findings were.
Okay, so this was actually the first introductory kind of board, just about the different types of accessory dwelling units. Internal and detached ones, which are allowed now, drawings I think were meant to depict that. Chris Lasky, the code enforcement director, tells me that the most common types of accessory dwelling units that have been approved are either over an attached garage or in a basement, which is often like a half-sunk level, like a split-level house or something like that. So but those are meant to depict typically what people have currently been turning into accessory dwellings. What the planning was. What we're going to look at is detached ones, as I mentioned, so this is just meant to illustrate that. This is a little illustration of one above a garage, or just a freestanding one. We included this poster because this is produced by the AARP, the American Association of Retired Persons, and they're doing a lot of publicity at the moment, trying to expand housing options for people of all ages, as I mentioned. And so they've got some nice pictures. These two are detached ones, and these are internal or attached ones. So it's just more images for you to look at to get a sense of what's being talked about. To that we've added that's just a typical attached dwelling on the side of looks like a ranch house. This one's on the lower level of the dwelling, probably a dwelling on a sloping side. And this is one that's in Bedford. This is a highly energy efficient one on Hillside Road, which is attached at the back of a Victorian type of house.
When this says now,
so potential detached ones. This is a little one above a garage in Barnstable on the Cape. This one's from the West Coast, from Oregon, where these things have taken off in quite a big way. There's quite a lot of interest in backyard dwellings, often on relatively small yard lots. And quite a few of them are like the tiny house movement. This one's in Northampton. And these are in Lincoln, where I used to work there. I think the idea of detached dwellings was popular because people wanted to be able to stay in town and have their rental income. Also, there are quite a lot of large properties that had old barns or carriage houses, so it seemed like a good reuse for those. So they were starting with slightly different considerations or circumstances, but that's kind of interesting. So I'd encourage you to take a close look. I know the pictures aren't very easy to see from there, so I don't know if I come up or want to walk around with it.
Is there questions? There's a lot more involved, like plumbing and sewage, and stuff like that, and wiring to it.
That is true.
So so I, if I was going to do it, I'd probably lean more towards putting it onto my own home, over the garage or in the basement or
sure.
something
yeah.
like that.
Sure, might depend if you've got a suitable place. It might depend on the shape of your lot or whatever, but yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, but it's more expensive, is what she's saying, to create that.
Yeah.
It's going to be a much more expensive proposition than to put something internally or attached to the unit that already exists.
Sure.
So if,
that's generally
so,
true. That depends a bit on whether your house is the shape and size and layout on the lot that works. So
what you were saying earlier, though, I think, is that you're looking at, or what Amy was saying earlier, is that this is intended to give a look at detached units added on to properties, and that's where you're starting. You're not really focusing on the internal attached units. Is
well,
that correct?
Well, they're already allowed under the current bylaw, so we're trying
they
to focus
allowed,
on what the choices would what the changes to the bylaw would be, so we're not taking away those.
But you're not talking about changing the current existing internal zoning. The zoning
not
for
in
internal.
Not in principle, no. No, just, you know, like we talked about potentially changing some of the size rules and so on, but no, in principle it would pretty much stay the same.
But would you change
but
the size
limit? The size limit is the main change that would affect the internal or attached ones.
So this size limit would be applied to internal as well as to external.
As the planning board's currently proposing it, yeah.
Okay.
Are there any
regulations? This is all straw man stuff. There's
just
so many different attributes to all of this. We need to throw something up to get people's opinions so we could start to really craft and hone in on something that people in town actually
so
want
as far as size,
for themselves and to see in their neighbor's yard.
Sorry.
That's okay. Once an ADU has been approved for and gone through the zoning or and building department and so forth like that, if somebody wants to convert it then to their own living space and make it a single family home rather than a single family home with an ADU, is there any regulation to that or can they just do that? So therefore you can then increase the size of the home regardless of the lot size.
Well, right now the zoning does not limit the size of houses. So if you're talking about an attached unit, there's no current upper limit on how big a house someone can build as long as they meet the setbacks. So,
and
the height, right.
One of the beauties of these things is like you can float in and out between needing to have somebody from your family to use something like this, and then at some point maybe you don't need anybody. You could have a renter that's supplementing your income,
or you
for
can
another,
make it all your living space,
or you can make it for the she shed
or
the
for a business space. As in, you can open an office.
The rules apply to offices.
Yeah.
You can have a home business if you're not employing anyone or having people coming to it as a business without having to get any special permit or anything. If you're going to be employing people or having people coming to it as customers, then you have to go through the ZBA to get a special permit. So those rules would still apply. So yes, in principle, a detached unit could change from being an accessory dwelling to being a home business, provided it, you know, met those rules. Or an attached unit could become part of simply a larger single-family house.
Could somebody build a detached unit and then at some point decide they want to condominiumize their property?
No.
No, it has to remain one ownership on the parcel.
So if you constructed a house.
Well, yeah, but if it were, you could still make a condominium, even if you were living in one side and somebody else lived in the
no,
other
because
side.
It would,
so
that yeah, some towns have put in specific wording to say that's not allowed, and that's certainly the intention, that it couldn't become like, that's effectively separate ownership, so that's not the intention.
Yeah, we're not trying to divide parcels any more than they are, we're just trying to allow people that have their own space to use it more to their advantage.
Basically a condominium, it is still one lot, but the units can be sold separately, and that's not the intention.
But even the basis, because my
I would, I'm going to guess here, but I would guess if you went around and personally surveyed everybody in town about on this subject, you're going to find the overwhelming number of people are more interested in the converting an attached existing structure to building something new.
Mm-hmm.
Just mm-hmm. for the economics.
Mm-hmm.
So I really think your focus needs to be on that.
Mm-hmm. Well, like I say, those are already allowed, so it's simply broadening out the options.
Right. Well,
but I agree that it's more expensive to do
that.
But the changes that are being envisioned to the bylaw in order to be able to have the detached units be small and modest and not change the character of the town and not change the streetscape, if you apply those same dimensional requirements to an attached existing structure, then you're actually disadvantaging people who might want to take advantage of the existing ADU bylaw as it is now. So one of the questions is, what are you trying to encourage people to do? Are you trying to encourage people to take advantage of this new opportunity to build something new on their property? Or should you be focusing more on liberalizing the existing ADU requirements by things like eliminating the requirement for the second parking space or things like that and see if maybe that would generate more interest? I think there probably are some people who might be interested in building something, but it is so much more expensive than converting. So I don't disagree that we should have that as a possibility of a detached, and I'm aware that there was an instance a number of years ago where there was actually a disabled adult child of a family, where the family wanted to build this disabled adult child his own apartment in an existing carriage house or garage that was not attached, and there was no way to attach it. Sometimes they're close enough you can kind of build something to bridge. And so an existing structure on an existing lot with an existing family who simply wanted to convert the space for a living space for their adult son could not be accommodated under this bylaw. So I would love to see that sort of thing be allowed, that you should be able to, if you have a garage or something you want to, and it does not attach to your house. But at the same time, I don't want to disadvantage the people who might be able to do something within the envelope of their existing space.
So you're mainly cautioning against tightening the rules for the existing attached.
Great feedback, though. So decoupling these two things a little bit more to make it clear so that people, I mean, and to your point, there are a lot of houses where there's a lot of flexibility and you can create your stuff, but there are some parcels in town where it'd be easier and maybe more convenient, or just prefer the option of having a separate unit, and you want to be able to give those people the option too.
Sure. Yeah. I do think, though, in discussing this stuff, I think one of the conversations that keeps spinning around, and I keep getting confused, is turning existing space within the envelope of your house into an ADU as versus adding on to the existing house as versus detached.
Yeah.
And I don't have the space in my house to convert what I already have. But I do want, I plan on living there until my daughter rolls me in a wheelchair into the Concord River. So, and we're going to do it in Madeline Altman's house because she's got the next scale. We've all got this played out. So, you know, I have to add it onto the side of my house, but I don't want it detached. I mean, then you start to put all the setback, and then I lose what yard I have.
So the real reason we're here is we're just trying to create more flexibility in town for people to be able to afford to live here. So if it means, you know, dividing it up into two or three different things to make it more clear, that's a great idea.
And the other thing is it's you're allowed one accessory apartment?
Yes, just one.
Okay.
And it's limited to two bedrooms as well. There's not, the board isn't currently thinking of changing that.
Any comments? Well, I think that the freestanding detached ones, probably what people will care more about is the appearance and sort of does it feel like to people as though it's like visual clutter or something like that. So I do think that separating, because there are different issues and different concerns if you're talking about conversion of something that already exists or something that's already attached or something that is internal to the building envelope. than there are if you're talking granny flats and granny pods or, you know, whatever they're called now, where you're actually going to build something new in your backyard.
So perhaps change, so instead of aiming for one bylaw change, we're aiming for a couple of different articles that would address these things separately. Would that help people?
There's going to be this school market.
I think so.
People go crazy with that.
What's the possibility?
And the other question is are you looking to accommodate the existing population of the town, or are you looking to, do you foresee this being existing families bringing their elderly into town to live with them?
I've heard a lot of people say, it's mainly this, or it's mainly this, but people have different ideas.
It could be increasing a younger generation of people, too, with these kinds of options.
It could be a wide variety of circumstances.
I mean, I think about it from in my particular case, because I do have a space that is appropriate to be an ADU, and I think of it as either a place for my adult child to live, or a place for me to live, and maybe my adult children who live in my main house. I plan to make it a handicap accessible, first floor, master bedroom, everything accessible, so that, I mean, my parents are elderly enough, I don't anticipate that they want to, at this late stage in the game, relocate to Massachusetts, so I don't think I'm bringing in new older people. I'm more thinking about the longevity of my being able to live, especially when you think about the time, energy, and money it takes to keep up a property as large as mine. There, the day will come where I'll need more able-bodied people to help me than I can possibly be able to do myself. And so I can envision a multi-generational family on my property that allows me to stay in town. So that's my, I mean, I'm not 50 yet, but like that's my long-term goal.
I think the multi-generational concept is kind of key, right? And it's becoming more and more popular kind of by default all over the country, just out of necessity, but is kind of, you know, to my point earlier, I was trying to raise about community. I mean, you're going to build way deeper communities with that kind of intergenerational stuff happening along the street. A lot more interactions, you know, people encountering each other.
And one of the other clusters of population that I've never really, not ever been in the situation, I haven't really figured out how they cope with is when parents divorce in Bedford. They both want to stay in town so their kid isn't schlepping in on a bus.
Who can afford $2 million bus?
So should we be putting our stickies on
this board? So please get your stickers on this board and we'll move on to the next board.
So let's see. So these are yellow post-its. So the idea is, as we're discussing, and feel free to talk out loud, want to hear all your thoughts out loud, but in addition to that, any important thoughts or what you reiterate, say on a post-it, put it on here, and then we'll make sure that it gets incorporated into the final findings of the meeting and work it forward. So actually, this is kind of simple. So what we're trying to do is just with the, let's read it so I don't speak out of turn too much. So what we're looking to, so except for non-conforming properties. So what we're trying to do this first pass around, because there are so many different attributes involved in how you want to craft a bylaw, especially when it comes to these new detached units, which we don't have anything on the book for, is to do it on conforming properties to begin with. We know that's like not a lot of housing stock, but it's like a good place to start to see what kind of interest we get, and it's easier to kind of define what it is. Then after that, the idea would be to try to figure out ways forward to try to be able to give everybody in town, conforming or non-conforming lots, the ability to put something on their property if they wanted to.
So I'm sorry. So you said special permit for non-conforming lots, but I thought I heard you say that. Are a lot of properties non-conforming? Do we know?
Yes, we have a lot of non-conforming, especially towards the center of town.
Yes, that I understand. Mm-hmm. But is it 80%? Is it 95%? I mean, conforming.
That's a chef, but I don't know all those stats on the top of my head.
Hi, Cindy, Michelle Pintillo, 251 Old Bill Ricker Road.
Thanks. I can ask Catherine that. I think it's more than you assume, though. Tony. What's the percentage of non-conforming lots in town versus conforming for residential? I think it's,
she did do an analysis. I don't remember what she did.
But they're not necessarily anything that you want to make.
It is not the majority.
So you missed the beginning, but we're going to go, like, there's five different topic areas, and we're going to, so this is per topic area. There's different color posties, and we're going to try to keep everybody going.
It's about permitting.
So,
is it possible to give an example of, like, a house or a neighborhood that would be a candidate? Because I'm thinking of stuff like this, like, we could put one at my house,
yeah.
But we probably couldn't put one at the house across the street on Pine Hill Road. It's a little ranch there. Mm-hmm. Maybe there's space, but like 30% of that is probably not a livable space. So like if we're thinking of like Wildwood Beverly neighborhood, which kind of splits and colonials and, you know, maybe what, 2,500 square feet? Like, is that the kind of thing that we're looking at?
Or yeah, I think anything
more of the, like, those the newer, bigger things that would have more space, but with those... Would the people living in those houses be inclined to want an ADU?
Right.
I don't know.
All right. So, yeah. So the first part of the question, I think, is it's pretty much the conforming lots are kind of residential. And off the top of my head, it's A and B. They're like the 30,000 and 50,000 square foot lots that make it really easy to kind of try to figure out how you would incorporate an accessory dwelling unit on your lot. It's the smaller ones that are very smaller and weird shape, kind of towards the center of town right now, that will probably pass at for this first iteration, just because there's so many constraints to kind of figure out. What we're trying to do is balance between what the homeowner would want to make it happen and what is going to make the neighbor happy too, and to marry those two things in a way that we can move forward. But the idea in general is just that
you wouldn't have to go through a special permit for a lot of situations if you're in a lot that's conforming.
If you're in
a conforming situation, you don't have to ask for special permission to build any of these things.
That's an assumption that the town is making?
So what we're doing tonight here is we're putting up, this is like a straw man for what we would like to put in the zoning bylaw in the fall. So what we're here tonight is like, that's our idea.
So let me give you
tell us what you think about it.
Let me give you an example.
Sure.
My neighbor has a conforming lot, put up, quote unquote, a garage with an apartment above it. I am now staring at an entirely second house. Okay? Now, granted, it was before the zoning required a 35-foot minimum or maximum on height. But there is literally a second home that I stare at out of my kitchen window.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I don't think that there should be any assumption that an accessory should be buildable simply because a lot is conforming.
So how would you propose if your neighbor wanted to build it in an official kind of way? How would they'd have to go through a special permit to get neighbor approval to do it?
Well, first of all, it's not the neighbors who approve or disapprove when a special permit comes before the zoning board of appeals.
Well, but there is a hearing, and the neighbors get to be
voice,
heard
yes.
in the hearing, and that's, I think, supposed to be important to the ZBA when they make the decision.
I can tell you it is very important. I've been on the zoning board of appeals for 5 years, and yes, a butter's concerns are taken into consideration, but that doesn't mean necessarily that they have the final decision making.
Right. So this is always a fun gray area between planning and ZBA about rule creation and rule enforcement. And it is a little fuzzy in general sometimes. Not really answering your question very well, but I mean, in a perfect world, we come up with a package that is by right, and everybody in town's comfortable with it because we voted for it. So if your neighbor put something up, it would be in by the rules that we defined, which might mean, and we'll get to these other boards, or things like you can't have a window facing, you know, the neighbor or something like that, or the entrances. We're talking, you know, there's all sorts of ways to mitigate the impact on the neighbor when you create an accessory dwelling unit on your property. So, and that again is that balancing act that we're trying to find.
So, I'm sorry, go ahead. Well, I'm curious what generated the interest in detached accessory dwellings as opposed to attached accessory dwellings.
So we're looking at both still. I mean, we have one already on the books. We're looking to kind of liberalize that one a little bit too, or change it to make it go in line with everything else. But the idea in general is that housing stock is unaffordable for a lot of people. And for right now, we're at a quarter percentage of our population that's over 65, is going to 33% in the next 10 years. A lot of these people are saying, I want to stay in town, but I don't want to live in my house, but I can't afford to move. I can't afford to keep it up either, the house that I'm in. What are my options? We don't have any other small housing stocks in town. So what this does is provide on your property the opportunity for you to build a situation where you can downsize into it, you can rent out the front to somebody else, you could have your kids live there, and it becomes an intergenerational thing. It could be that you stay in the big house, and your kids who had too much debt from college have to come back and live with you. You don't want them in the same house. You want them, you know, close by. But you know, there's all sorts of scenarios. So the idea is without you know, creating a lot of more 40Bs for people to have opportunities to stay in town, how else can we provide opportunities for people, especially people that are already in town, to stay in town?
So, I understand that that's the goal, but what would ever prevent anyone from building an accessory apartment and simply renting it out as a second income, as an income-producing property?
That's a property.
And there's no way to prevent
that. That's one of the options.
No, that's actually, we want to be able to let people do that by right.
Sell and rent, right? You could sell your house and then you'd have another
rent someone else's.
To rent.
But if I rent one of these, I'm subject to landlord misbehaviors because it changes.
But this isn't going to solve that problem.
No, you can get a longer term.
So let's talk about your thoughts about parking.
So, actually, Doreen, you had mentioned parking before. So here's the parking one. So right now the ADU parking regulation is 2, so we were thinking of reducing that. Some board members actually say maybe no parking requirements because it's possible you could be taking public transit or biking or something, but keeping the rules about location and visual screening. Okay, so here you have a case where you have a 2-car garage and 2 spaces in front, and you could have an ADU, let's say, above the garage, and that would satisfy that.
That has 6 spaces. I mean,
at least 2 spaces.
Officially, it may be 2 spaces, but
right.
I have a driveway just like that, and we park 5 cars in it when we have company.
Yeah.
And is that not considered, therefore, I mean, I can't just say my accessory use person can have a park in our driveway as is?
Well, that's what we're saying. Yes, what we're trying to do is, the planning board is advocating reducing the existing parking requirements. Now, this does actually look like it would fit more cars. But theoretically, if this was a 2-space driveway, the way it's drawn and lined out, what we're trying to say is, why not have your ADU person park in your driveway if that's what you as a homeowner want, rather than mandate the construction of extra parking, which may prohibit you from putting the ADU in if you have no place to put the parking. And it may be totally unnecessary if, let's say, your ADU is going to be occupied by a senior that's going to take the BLC or the 62 bus.
Well, that's what I'm asking. So would I be, even if you reduce it to one, would I be required to build an additional parking space?
That's what we're up for discussion. My view is, no, we shouldn't require anybody to build any parking spaces. There are other voices that we've heard on the board, people that are concerned that if you do that, you'll have people parking on lawns. Because you'll let someone put an ADU, there's no place to park, they'll park on their lawn, they'll make the neighborhood look awful. So that's the balance. However, like I said, my thought is that if we're really targeting these towards people that may be downsizing seniors, maybe young couples. Not everybody has a car per person. Not everybody these days even has a car. There are bike commuters. There are people that may work from home that might just get transport from elsewhere. So that's what we're looking for feedback on. What do people think if we take out that parking or put it to one or maybe do it by zone?
Yeah, I agree that I don't think you should have to build anything, especially because in the not too distant future we're gonna have a lot more car sharing. You know, autonomous vehicles that people actually don't own but that they call up at on demand and stuff. So to start imposing parking requirements just seems crazy to me. I would like to go at the least restrictive direction.
So again, the market will probably say that. I sell my house, I rent one of these things, I'm looking for one with a garage so I don't have to scrape my car off in the wintertime. So, let the market decide. So that says no restrictions except for what whomever builds these things want to have.
Yeah, you can choose to. I mean, let's say your cousin lives with you and they want you to build an ADU that has a garage. This doesn't stop that.
Don't say that loud enough for them to hear.
Well, I'm being broadcast, so I don't know if your cousin watches you on TV.
But that's a really good point. It's like, how could you build a garage with an ADU? What would allow that?
Let's say you have a large enough lot, and we can imagine some of those we had up before where it's further back, and somebody has like a one-car garage with their living space on top and maybe something on the side all under 800 square feet.
Would the garage be part of the 800 whatever feet?
Yeah.
Okay, so then it would reduce.
That makes it tiny.
Is that right, Sean? Yeah. You would count truly a garage, can be used for no other purpose, would count as part of the 800 square feet?
Again, remember, this is up for discussion.
Yeah, okay.
But if we counted gross square area, that would be part of it. If we choose to specifically exempt a garage in the bylaw, then that's possible too.
If you don't, you'll see tents and carports. More than likely.
Yeah.
Now you don't see that.
But I think also, remember, this isn't just about garages. This is about, do we have to make like a driveway for an ADU?
Well, if you have a new garage, you probably have to make a driveway.
If you have a garage. But could you put something off in the back of your house if you had no extra parking requirement and maybe just have a walkway there, which you could do if you don't need to construct another parking spot.
But if my driveway is considered big enough to have three spots instead of just the two that usually are in it, would I still have to build a driveway to the accessory unit? Years ago, do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
In that first picture there, if it was allowed to have three cars in it and the accessory unit was behind the house,
then you shouldn't have to put a driveway there. You could park here and put a side path.
Okay.
Again, that would be up to the owner.
Okay.
But I think Rich, and you're both making a really good point. Well, Rich's point is you want to cover, a lot of seniors want to cover a garage. That's pretty true. But then not having to walk a long distance. I mean, right now, none of us has to walk very far to get into our house, right, most of the time? So to make seniors walk far, I don't know.
The solution for either of those problems, either needing a garage or Yeah.
And also, there was some interesting discussion before about whether you count a garage as 800 square feet. And right now you would. And kind of I think the rationale is because they don't want people putting in an ADU with a garage that isn't counted and then have the garage finished later. And what do you do about it? And you can't. So, but like I said, that's up for discussion.
I think, do we have another board?
I think there's one more board voting. Yeah, the permitting process. But we got time on this.
I'll hold that. I'll lock that up. Has nothing to do with parking.
You can build an attached accessory development unit that can have just be right there.
Exactly. It's more accessible.
And so right. Maybe uses the same garage depending as the main unit, right?
Yeah. There was room. You could conceive of that you have a garage and you have accesses to both units.
Good.
Yeah, these are really good thoughts, good ideas.
I truly believe a lot of the problems we're talking about would go away if we said that here are two separate dwelling units and they can be condominiums. Because we're already doing that in town. People
that's
are doing
not
that
the problem.
Already.
We're talking about making more affordable
but that's
housing.
That's what you do. The same. It's 800 feet. It's exactly the same thing, except it's a condominium.
So buy a piece of land that you can build two units on, and then you can have your condos. I mean, I don't know why you want us to subdivide our quarter acre lots
to have
condos
you can't.
On them.
Well,
yeah.
But you don't have to. You could.
Why would you want that
because
to happen
I
in
own
Bedford?
That house and live there until I croak in Bedford. And I want to be
the
last
place
the house.
And own the house and rent the main building.
I don't want to be a landlord. You know, it does address those issues. It does address those issues.
So you want more condos?
That's a whole different
condos
solution.
In this situation. There's one across, right? There's two right across from me right now. They work. That's what the owners wanted to do.
On the corner there?
Yeah. Those are attached.
Those are really nice.
And Gene Clerkins, he's going to condominiumize that as soon as he wants to.
Yeah.
So it's working, and I don't know, those are the two situations I know about. But it resolves the issues of being a landlord, ownership, garages. They're separately owned structures. What's wrong with that?
But that's not an accessory
so maybe
dwelling.
Maybe
that's a different thing.
It's the same price. It's the same size.
Yeah. Maybe what you're saying is you would like a bylaw that does that.
In addition to this, yeah.
So then maybe that's something that the planning board can take.
Yeah, I mean, that's certainly an option.
Or after we build these, now comes the bylaw that says they can now be condominiums, for instance.
So you would have... Effectively, they'd share the parcel of land under a
just like a condominium would.
But they'd have the separate.
So now I take all the equity out of my house and take half of it and buy half a house, okay, and have the rest of it to gamble whatever I want to do. Again, that's probably not here in this ADU discussion. But it's a concept that is follow-on to this kind of thing in terms of how people want to live. You're right. There's no place in Bedford to buy a $400,000 house.
Anything.
Or anything like this.
Yeah. I know. Yeah, that's
partly
so
what
hard.
We're talking about, trying to create here.
Because we can't change the market. And the planning board, we always see these developments come in and... You know, they'll put all these units in and their townhouses, and they say they'll sell them for affordable, and then they go on the market, and the market gets what the market gets, and it's like $700,000.
But they don't come in as 800 square feet.
Right, so that's why we think this is different than those.
Yeah.
This is fundamentally different from what we're getting in those developments because we have that restriction on size.
It's working in Portland, Oregon, condominiums.
Actually,
it's working in lots of places.
A lot of the best material for ADUs and addressing this issue actually come from the West Coast, the Northwest.
People in the Northwest live in much long homes. I mean, I think it's sort of unique to the Northeast, maybe the Southeast. People just live in, we live in much bigger houses. Maybe because we have lousy weather. Inside the year, I don't know, but
It's very different in like Seattle.
Seattle has lousy weather, not snow, but lousy weather.
And they have really small houses there.
Yeah.
In general.
But we don't have bylaws that encourage condos and apartment houses. To in the gray, and maybe, and I'm not saying we do want that, but you know, there are the Carlisle has recently built some sort of older person housing, semi-detached, I think they are really sort of, and but I don't know that we how that works within our current bylaws if we could allow such a thing, and again, how you could make it affordable.
Carlisle has 3-acre zoning for one of these 800 square foot units.
Yeah, well, then maybe it makes sense for them to be able to condominium. But when we're talking about many of our in-town lots that are just
I thought I heard the alarm for the next.
It did.
So okay, so we should get permitting processed then. And any last thoughts on parking or any stickies for?
That seems like a really complicated. Well, just all of it seems really.
Yeah, but it. I think that we've heard a consensus. It seems that people don't want to force us to add parking. I think you had a really good point about the autonomous cars. Look into the future, because you can imagine that you go on to the internet. Yeah, we're going to rotate, and
you call your car,
and your car doesn't need to be parked anyplace.
By constraining yourself. Great caveat out of it, and there's a lot of sympathy to that to keep people in the town they've lived in for a long time. So that was one factor. The other factor there was that there are a lot of large lots, and some of them have. Old barns or old carriage houses, so there was an argument for reuse of those particular buildings, maybe built before a certain date or whatever. So it does work out differently in different towns. We've tried to think what is relevant to Bedford.
One question I had was that the accessory building must be farther back than the rear of the main house, because I'm looking at the picture that you handed out.
Yeah. Or the front.
But that's allowed by right. Attached.
Right. Yeah. The bottom picture.
Oh, it's attached. Yeah. Okay, so
the bottom picture does show it detached and still parallel with the front.
Well, yeah, the bottom picture shows it parallel.
Yeah, the perspective.
I mean.
For drawing.
It's on the same horizon.
Yeah, okay.
I would interpret it right.
So that second bullet
is maybe it's going to the back.
The second
bullet. That's why I drew the 3-day here to pick it up.
We're going to process of attaching it. It's been a
break. So feel free to jot down any comments. We get stuck on the board, and then we'll move to the next.
Did I miss the idea of how big these are?
Oh, the size isn't on this board. We've got a separate board for the size where we're going to get into the square footage and so on.
All right, and then what if the... So
this is really mainly about the setbacks and any sort of particular design rules.
So what are... So some lots in the C residence, for example, are not the 25,000 square foot.
Well, if they're less than 25,000, then they're non-conforming, because residence C at the moment it has a minimum 25,000.
Okay, so that would become a non...
If they're older than that, then they can't... They're called legal non-conforming, and they're protected for being as they are, but if you want to change them, you have to go to the ZBA for a special permit usually.
You can't face the neighborhood.
Right. Because I thought, do you know the law now? Can the door face the public way? Or I thought that it had to...
For the attached ones, there are some fairly strict rules. Yeah, you're not supposed to have a second door facing the street. You're supposed to have it on the side or the back.
It doesn't look like a two-family.
So they must have thought that was...
No, I think it just doesn't have... It can't look... It has to look like a garage access door as opposed to a front door. So if you have two,
the wording,
one's fancy and one's not, then you can...
The wording is has to have maintain the appearance of a single-family.
Right. So usually they're on the side or back or whatever, but it,
I'm really not.
Yeah. I mean, some people will say, well, that's a bit.
I've been
looking at a bit fussy on the other hand, you know, if it's what makes it acceptable.
They
and
all
it gets
the ones
the
that are
allowed, you know, it's
all
a compromise.
The garage have the door facing the street, actually. So
it just looks like a garage.
It just looks like a garage door, mm-hmm. as opposed to mm-hmm. the front door. So mm-hmm. so there must be there. Must
I think there's a rule. I think there's a rule if you've already got two entrances, because some houses were built in the first place with two front facing doors. So I think there's some rule about. Anyway, we're not proposing changing that.
Okay, whatever it is. That's
okay. Okay.
So just
I mean, because I mean, I just personally don't mind.
No.
Just stick them up.
Yeah, just stick them wherever you want. If it relates to something specific, put it next to it. But otherwise, just put it anywhere. So you've just got to give us that next button in a
moment. So right now, what we have is 30% of your main thing. So of your main drawing.
Do you want to register the stick on? So
what we've talked about today is to try to bring them in line for equity reasons. 800 internal.
What was this diagram?
Oh, Tony drew this just to show. Right, he's drawn in detail some alternative setbacks. One is the existing setbacks for principal structures, which means the house. So that would give you a 30-foot rear setback as well as a 35-foot front setback. So that's one possibility. The border is moving towards either the 10 or 15 foot. So yes, it shows all the different. So if you want to look at it, everyone wants to look at it in detail, come and take a close look.
Okay, so.
Yes.
So it should show you a few variations as to where the accessories are built because of the underlying differences.
Well, I mean, you can give or take some of that, but the rationale is that we're not looking at creating a second house in the multifamily sense. It's really meant to be an accessory unit that we kind of envision would probably be occupied by one or two people.
So if you have a 4,000 square feet main house, you cannot build 1,200 square feet accessory?
That would be, yes, what we're advocating as of right now, that would be the case.
You can or you cannot?
You cannot.
You'll be limited.
But I think it's also, I'm sorry for interrupting, Sean, but I thought from listening to Amy that that's about the average size that we're seeing in the Commonwealth now for ADUs is about 800 square feet or 700 to 800. So is that adequate?
You can certainly get two bedrooms and a good living space in 800 feet. Yeah.
So what happens if any of these changes are made and it's like the hope I don't offend anybody, but the Caesar Jones problem where it was an over 55, they were not well-built homes. They didn't sell, but they did have those restrictions and were allowed to build there, and then all of a sudden it all changes. I don't know what the legal process was, but it all changes because they were unable to sell there. So somebody builds a structure.
That's a little different. We're actually, sorry, jumping
into
the Caesar Jones. Haven't been on the selectmen when the Caesar Jones problem came to us. The over 55 limitation in Caesar Jones was something that the selectmen had the authority to do something about if we needed to. Appropriately convinced that the houses were not selling. There was no market for over 55 restrictions on those houses. But this is you're talking about a zoning bylaw. So the relief to zoning.
I'm like, so okay.
The relief to zoning is not the same as Gordon convincing the selectmen to change their application for them to the state.
And there wouldn't be an age restriction. We wouldn't be having, building these or saying.
So it's a purview.
We're not proposing.
The select board versus the
town meeting would have to.
But we're not proposing that these would be for any specific age demographic.
No, but I'm saying if somebody has a property where they build a house, they build a second thing, and they can't, and they, for the purpose of renting, not a purpose
they
of renting.
They have an 800 square foot detached unit in the backyard. Yeah. Can't rent it.
And they can't rent it. They can't rent it. And so, and it doesn't conform to what we're setting out here. So what happens then? Do they go back to the select board and they say?
No, I'm not understanding. Why would if it doesn't rent, I presume you would then look at the rent.
Right.
How much is somebody willing to pay to live in your, in the back of your property?
Oh, so cost analysis on what you're
same reason why you would put two things in a barn, whether one. No, I'm just curious because that was a flip on Caesar Jones. That was an awful flip.
I think it's just a very different,
completely different scenario. That could not happen.
So, I mean, what's going to happen is if a homeowner chooses to put an ADU there, they're acting like a business person. They're going to choose to rent it. The town isn't going to come and rent it for them, or the selectmen are going to get involved. We do have pretty good data, though, with the recent housing study that was done, that there is a demand for these type of units at the expected price points. So I think as long as the rent was reasonable in the market that we can expect today and probably for the foreseeable future, that shouldn't be an issue in terms of these vacancies.
How about the setbacks that Jeff came in? Right now, the detached garage or
10 feet.
It's only 10
from the side or rear yard. And it has to be behind the rearmost point of the primary dwelling.
Right. But this one would not have those limitations. We're trying to.
I think we're looking at 15 feet from the side and the rear.
Okay. Instead of 30,
there's actually another board that's going to come through.
Yeah, so we'll be able to talk about that more in detail, but you captured accurately what we were proposing. Yeah.
But we're looking at height, I think, too. I think the consensus of the board was we wouldn't want to go more than 1.5 stories, 25 feet, which now that I believe they actually have a couple of units framed or underway up on the Pine Hill Crossing. So if you want to put it in context, you could look at some of those new units and get an idea or a feel for what that height is.
And we're going to be talking too much, but like when Amy was saying, you know, people live in a 4,000 square feet home, and you know, I don't think anybody living in a subdivision that has a 4,000 square feet home is going to put a detached unit. If anything, like me, I have a 4,000 square feet home, and I put an accessory apartment. I have a family of 5 plus my parents, so at the time I thought it was a great deal when I did it, but I don't think. Oh, ever, it's in my basement. And I purposely bought that lot with the walk-out basement and all that to accommodate that, and everything is on the books. But I don't think anybody else in a subdivision like that would want to put a unit on their lot and rent it out, per se. But most homes, they cannot accommodate an accessory apartment the way it's written, because you need to have access, egress, separate door, you know, an hour-rated, you know, partitioning and all that. So. I think this is going to affect more the smaller, you know, single-family homes that people want to just pop a 800 square feet to create a rental in most cases.
But I think one of the conversations we were having had to do with, I think Mark brought it up, you know, you have conforming lots that have adequate area, and you have non-conforming lots that are undersized. You know, you allow a detached ADU on an undersized lot. We have to have that discussion.
Exactly.
You know, do you say no? In no situation would you allow that, or do you do it by special permit? Or, you know, that's so. There's some details and some further discussions that we really need to have and iron out.
But right now we are dealing with that in ZBA. I mean, every change you want to make over 600 square feet, they come in front of us, whether they want to add a, you know, a second whatever, right? We see at least one or two.
Well, that's another board too, is the special permit versus by rights.
Right, right.
Is any other thoughts?
How do people feel about the height? You know, is that off-putting, or is it?
Is that only applicable to new structures, or would that be applicable to existing structures? Let's say you had a barn that was over 25 feet tall.
That's a good question.
Would grandfather provisions that might be one of those things that occur if you change the use? If you're talking about like repurposing an existing structure like a barn into a new, we'd have to look into that.
And what if the main house is a ranch, a one-story ranch, and that would allow you to build something taller?
Yeah, that's another good point too.
So you're saying the detached new unit could be
within a range.
No, I know. So the other unit could be taller. Yeah.
So unless I miss what Mark said, there is no limitation on it.
Well, right now, yeah, we were kind of surprised to find that apparently you could build a garage taller than your house. If you own a ranch now, you could build a garage in the backyard.
Over 35 feet, really?
Well, oh, yeah. There's no height limitation on an accessory structure.
That's one of those
I should try it just to see what would happen.
Yeah. Build the big tower of garage.
Seems like if we do nothing else, we should at least.
Yeah, that seems to me like that is.
We're meeting out that.
So thank you all again for coming and sharing all your thoughts and listening and entertaining our initial ideas of what we would like to do with these zoning bylaws. Well, I'm going to ask you for a couple of takeaways, but before you guys degroup, just know that this is the beginning of the process. Our initial idea is to start an open public hearing, official public hearing sometime in the summer to discuss this some more. So anybody that you can encourage to join in on the conversation, and please come and tell us online, offline, in email, whatever, some more additional thoughts. We really want to, whatever we put up to the town, now we don't want it to be a complete surprise. We want people to understand what it is, and we want it to be something that's appealing to at least enough people to like put it forward. So thank you very much. How about what one group, what are the major takeaways? Did anybody have major takeaways that we should be considering? Minor ones are good too.
Oh, I think one of them was that you should be doing parallel process in terms of changing, in terms of changing the zoning laws for already constructed conversions as opposed to building new independent subjects.
Yeah, and if you weren't in Kathy's group, it was a great point. We were trying to squish into one article changes to interior existing units as well as create more wordage around doing detached units. So two separate articles or maybe even a third one, depending on how we work it, might be the way to go. So that's great feedback.
It would be interesting for this group here, looking at the demographics versus the demographics for this evening. I expect it to be a younger crowd. If there's a significant difference, I think both groups ought to know about what the differences were. That's if it's reportable, if it's identifiable, that kind of thing.
That is great feedback, and that's something that we're really interested in too, to get a wider range of people, demographics in town, and to get their feedback. So yes, if we get a different, well, regardless, we'll post some notes for what the major takeaways were for this afternoon and in the evening, so you can compare notes with the other group and then start to maybe engage with any of those people that you know that were there too. Anybody else? Amy?
Our group says yes.
Your group says yes.
Yes. All right.
Does anyone have any questions or additional comments that they'd like to make? Well, thank you all very, very much for coming out today.
Thank you.
Very much appreciate it.
Thank you, everyone.